Professor Vedavyas Mysore. I'm a professor at the PES University in Bangalore, and I have been in the IT industry for close to 30 years before moving to academics. I essentially teach strategy and entrepreneurship at the PES University, and as part of my industry experience as well as my professorship at PES University, I have been interacting with the other side, so to say, with the academic area when I was in the industry, and with the industry when I have been in the academics now. And over a period of time, I have seen that, at least in India, if you take the top 10 or 50, 10 or 15 institutes out of the equation, majority of the engineering or the management institutes, their interaction with the industry is essentially limited to the recruitment time when the academics act as a producer and the industry acts as a consumer of the fresh graduates. If you compare this with the model that is essentially used in the Western countries, especially the US and the Europe, where most of the innovation, the entrepreneurship, the research, most of those things happen in the academic setup with a lot of collaboration from the industry, one starts wondering why this doesn't happen in India and what we should do to make it happen. So, based on my interaction and my own experience, in this paper, I have proposed a conceptual maturity model for the industry academia interaction. My belief is that the maturity of the collaboration, where you start producing highly innovative work in an academic setup and then transfer it to the industry, thereby creating a highly research-oriented environment useful to both sides as well as the society, can happen only when you take the relationship between the industry and academia in a very staged, step-by-step way. And based on my own experience in the academics in the last 6 or 7 years, I think that is a more useful one to have rather than jump to different kinds of activities with no clear goals and no relationship having been built in. I have seen cases where the academic institutes try and start creating a lab without even understanding the industry properly, and usually such activities are doomed to failure. They give a very, very short, very short-term publicity, maybe, to produce a newspaper report, but beyond that, nothing really happens. So, what I have proposed here is, I hope, quite practical and something that can be really used. So, I hope you can see the PPT in front of you, which is the proposed maturity model for industry-academia interaction. So today we'll cover what is the context for the collaboration between the industry and the academia. What are the industry challenges? When you are in the industry keeps thinking not very highly, let me say, of the academia, saying, oh, the academia is, they only do sit in a corner and do research. They don't know the real industry problem. They don't face the real life problems and so on. And the academia have their own grouses or complaints about the industry. So how do we understand both and bring them together and make sure that they can collaborate? What are the challenges in the collaboration structure itself, and what kind of a maturity model am I proposing here, which will hopefully work? So this will be the coverage for this webinar, and at the end of it, we will have a interaction question answer kind of session. So let's understand the larger context first in terms of the National Mission for Digital India. If you look at the objectives of the National Mission for Digital India, it's quite obvious that the linkages between technical institutes, the industry, and the society at large, ultimately, both the technical institutes and the industry are trying to work together to benefit the society at large. If we have to do that, the collaboration between the technical institutes and the industry has to happen, and has to happen in a very structured and a matured way in order to produce the required benefits. And we know that the future economy, more than now, will be, you know, more and more technology driven, and it becomes more and more important for the growth of the economy of any country for the technology to be not only mature, but for every country, every society to be more innovative. And this innovation, at the end of the day, has to happen with collaboration between these two entities. So there is no, I don't think any of us can question the fact that the government, the educational institutes, the technical institutes and the industry have to work much more closely than we have done in the past. And today it is more not only relevant, but even more immediate and imperative that we do the. So which means new models of learning and co-ed, the old models of looking for the industry to look at the academia, or the academia to kind of consider the industry in a different light, has to go. We have to all work together in the interest of the larger society. Okay. So what I have proposed here is a five-stage maturity model. It means is this model, I would not say it's a proven model, but it's a sensible, you know, workable model, and fairly easy to implement in my view. The context for the collaboration, of course, if you start looking at some of the numbers, is that we will have something like 400 million youth according to the latest census in the 25 to 35 years age group, and inability to keep them productively occupied can, you know, definitely spell a social disaster. But if we have to employ them, we need a lot more entrepreneurship. All this whole objective of Digital India is creating more of entrepreneurs. And how do you create more of entrepreneurs if you don't innovate more and more? And how will you innovate more and more if the academic people are not working on research which is directly affecting the society and which is directly being put forward by the industry? So that is really the, you know, context for the collaboration. Okay. So the imperatives for the industry-academia collaboration is very much there, but the gaps are increasing every day. So it puts this whole collaboration model itself in a light of being an absolute necessity for everybody to work together in the interest of the society. If you look at the industry and take their point of view, the time to market is shortening. You know, we all heard of this, the VUCA that everybody keeps talking about. The market has become volatile, uncertain, ambiguous and all that. So the time to market is shortening. So the industry almost thinks that, you know, they don't have time even to work with the academics, because for them the time to market to the industry is to the market is shortening, and that is really putting constraints on them. So they have to take technology, assimilate the technology, you know, come out with new products, go to the market, you know, make money, innovate, improve, which where the time is of essence. And they say the business cannot wait. There's no learning curve time for new employees. So with better industry academy interaction, this learning curve can definitely come down. If you look at the, as we look at the steps of the maturity model, you can see, we'll see that the learning curve can be greatly reduced. Third one, of course, is capital is squeezed. There is always a shortage of capital for the industry to do new things. And the academics can actually act as their back-end, with contract research, with contract work with the academics, they can actually use it as a back office for doing a lot of new experiments with help from the academia. The fourth one, of course, is knowledge is exploding so much in this world of Google and other technologies. Knowledge is expanding so much that no industry or the academic can really claim to be up to date with everything. And it's only natural that industries collaborate with the academics to come up, come out of this challenge. Then, of course, globalization, both industry, and education are becoming globalized. So every one of the biggest problems that the industry faces today is, how do I compete in the global market? So far, most of the companies have been competing in the local market, but with the opening international borders, with the WTO and other things, it has become very important to be global. So can collaboration with academics lead to improved competitiveness in the global scenario is another big question. Then, of course, the knowledge churn, what is relevant today is obsolete in a few months from now. So the knowledge churn itself is very high. So apart from the business challenges, the knowledge, the technology that is coming up itself is is at a very high speed. And how does the industry gain this knowledge? Can the academic collaboration help in reducing this knowledge churn, or at least trying to keep up with the knowledge that is being generated? So the institute should look upon the industry's challenges as an opportunity to collaborate and help solve industry problems and act as I say extended arms of the industry, so that there's a big case therefore for a very structured collaboration model. Okay, obviously the benefits of doing this is create employable skills, because today the industries cannot even wait for the freshers to get trained for over a period of 6 months or 1 year. That is no more possible with things being so volatile, and they have to accelerate learning by students and faculty, and the industry problems have to be solved so quickly. So we have to speed up research, and this collaboration that the proposed model that I have given there will hopefully speed up the research and also bring the faculty up to date with industry. That is one thing that is, I think, in my personal experience, missing in a big way in the Indian context, the faculty not being up to date with what's happening in the industry. Okay, and we need to have some activities within the maturity model for making that happen. And then there is being able to develop new and improved technology in the institute labs to help solve industry problems. How do we pick up industry problems and put students or the latest technology possible within the academic area to solve those problems, then take it back to the industry for them to produce products? And how do we transfer those new innovative technologies which have been produced to the industry? Is it possible in a ad hoc kind of collaboration? It's not. So we need a very structured model for all this. So challenges in collaboration, I'm sure there are people who may not agree with some of this. What I have given here is just a sample. The list could go on and on. The industry generally feels that the academics or theorists and institutes are doing research that is not required by the industry. That's what the industry generally thinks. I remember when I was in the industry, we always used to think that the institutes are producing research just for publishing papers, and there is really no practical use for it, while the institutes feel quite differently, and the industry also feels that the pace at which institutes work is very relaxed. I can tell you for sure, now having been on the academic side now, I can tell you that that's not so. Okay, the institutes are all the best to do work in really good areas, but publishing papers is becoming more and more of a consequence, and hopefully that trend will increase. And the institutes feel that the corporates give a kind of stepmotherly treatment, so to say, to the institutes, and they really have no interest or the time, and that they do not understand the academic research and the rigor, because the academic research has its own rigor in terms of what to go through, what are the process you go through before arriving at a certain conclusion when you state a research problem. The institutes feel that the industries do not understand this, and they just want everything the next morning, and things are not going to have happen that way. So the institutes feel that whatever money they give to the the industry that gives money to the institute, and that is seen as more as an expense and not as an investment. I think that mindset has to definitely change if it is true, and they feel that the industry has no patience. So now you see how the collaboration is an absolute must. It is required for the country and for the society, but I'm sure both the industry and the institutes want to collaborate, but in many cases they try to collaborate without going through the structured collaboration process, end up failing, end up not sharing a mindset, and then end up not doing anything together. I think we need to come out of that, and I hope the proposed model will help improve this collaboration. Okay. What we have to understand is that any collaboration between an institute and academy and the industry also goes through kind of life cycle. Goes through infancy, it goes through growth, and then maturity. So there are baby steps that you have to take. There are highly energetic, high growth list of activities, and there is also the level of maturity where the two understand each other and know exactly how and where to work with each other. So a maturity model is quite useful at this stage, and this is basically inspired by the IT industry's capability maturity model, the CMM maturity model. I have just tried to see how the concept, the framework, can be applied to the industry-institute interaction. And each level is progressive, which means that each stage that I'm going to talk about is an accumulation of all the previous levels. So let's look at the level one, what I call as level one. Let us look at the characteristics of different levels, and then go into details of each level. So to me, level one is like a hands-off approach where the two still don't know each other. There is no regular interaction, but the interaction is quite random, and this is the stage where you start testing the waters with each other and trying to understand each other. So this is not yet a marriage. This is more like dating that happens between the two. Okay, then once they have understood each other, understood the strengths and weaknesses of the partners, then I think they need to move on to being engaged interaction, where they still engage with each other periodically, okay, not very frequent, but it's much more periodic, increasing the areas of collaboration, increasing the width of the relationship, and it's the trust starts building with each other. So that is when we say that we have reached level two. We can say we have reached level three of the collaboration when the interaction is much more continuous, when the engagement is there across different parts of both the entities. There are already defined processes for many activities, and each of them have taken a set of goals for each, like a set of annual goals for the collaboration itself. And there is a clearly established governance that cuts across different levels, and the relationship is reviewed at very senior levels. So as you see, as we go up the level, not only does the interaction become more frequent, but also becomes wider in scope and is now being looked upon as a fairly strategic thing by the senior management of both the organizations. I would say we would reach the level four of collaboration if there is mutual learning. So until now it has been interaction, each of them giving to the other, but if there is learning from both sides and integration of intellectual capital, joint production of IPR, joint publications and joint innovations, and now then you start become commercially oriented. Can your output, the collaborative output, can it be commercially exploited in the market for helping the society, or going global? Then you have reached level four. I would say you're at level five if together your output is producing jobs, producing a lot of innovation, measurable social rate of return, where the university or the technical institute has become an economic engine, so to say, for growth. So you can see that these different levels is taking you from being, you know, a hands-off approach to becoming an economic engine. So there is a level of maturity that one has to go through at each level before you move on to the next level. So let's look at what kind of activities can be there in level one. And it's not that these are the only activities at each of these levels. These are only suggested activities based on my own experience and what one comes to know after speaking to different entities, but it's by no means exhaustive, so to say. You can add more levels here depending on your comfort level. It is also not that these levels are strictly here, but because of the way I have structured the model and defined the levels, I feel that these are fit to be at these levels. Okay, so things, for example, internships, you know, and the industry giving equipment and licenses for the people to work on so that they become, the students become better skilled before they enter the industry, or giving library support. The academics, usually the academic institutes usually have lot of library support, lot of research subscriptions and so on. If they can provide that to the industry and make it accessible to them, establishment of professorship chairs in the institutes by the industry, providing scholarships to students, which many companies are doing today, but they are not looking at this as a very structured model where you can move from one level to another one. These are very initial activities, hands-off kind of activities, where the interaction has started, but we still cannot call it as, you know, a engagement mindset at this level. Okay, giving financial support and so on. I'm sure we can all add our own list of activities to this. After having done that, if you go through a good MOU, and if industry is, let us say, sitting on the advisory board faculty selection of creating the syllabus, helping the technical institute actually create the syllabus or upgrade it, and start giving guest lectures from the industry to the faculty and the students, giving them the status of the industry, how is the industry different from others, what are the growth prospects and so on, and letting the faculty and the students visit the industry, faculty spending time in the industry. I think faculty spending time in the industry is very important. So this may need industry as well as the institute to change some of their rules, or some of the way they compensate people, some of the way they give sabbaticals and so on. That faculty spending a few months in the industry every year, I think, is very important, as well as the industry sending their people, on sabbatical to the institute. Today, if you give opportunities, I know personally, and I'm sure you were also aware, that a lot of people in the industry would be happy to spend a few months, one quarter, let's say every 2 years or 3 years, in a institute, teaching and sharing with the faculty and the people. I think we need a structured model to make it happen. I think that's what is missing. Okay, and student projects in industry with an industry guide. I've seen, if you see the internships that happen in this country, most of it is, I think, lesser said the better in most cases. But the biggest problem is that the students, when they go to the industry and do the projects, their academic guide is switched off, or the industry guide is never available, or a combination of the two. I think some of these things continue to be challenges, but if we can collaborate better, I think this will ultimately help both the industry as well as the institute. And sponsoring seminars and events in institutes, of course, these are already happening. So if we look at this level two, the interaction is more engaged. Okay, it is still infrequent. Okay, but it's periodic, but it's not one-off. So it is level two. At level three, the interaction is much more continuous. The institute starts doing consulting assignments for the industry, Okay, so which means there is actually revenue being generated for the institute, which also means, of course, that there is much more seriousness on both sides. Okay, and that's very important. And establishing labs in the institutes by the industry, which are very dedicated either for a specific technology or a specific area in which the industry is engaged. And if the institutes are allowed to give certification courses, okay, certification courses with the industry, along with the industry, for students to make them ready for the skills that the students will need when they join the industry, you know, domain specific or company specific, that would be a great help. And joint publication of books, case studies and best practices and journal papers and all that. And having collaborative research facilities where there is an investment by both the parties to do research, address research issues in industry along with the academics. I'm happy to say that in our university, for example, some of these things, I think I would say that we are at level 3 doing some of these things for the industry, and I'm sure many more are also there. At level 4, of course, you are doing mutual learning, integrating intellectual capital, as I say it, and things like establishing centers of excellence. So institute and industry developing competencies together. That means we have started looking here, when we come to level 4, we have started looking at the future. We are not only leveraging each other's competencies to do new things, but also trying to look at the market. Now that is important. Joint IPR development, doing contract research, continuous education for industry employees. If today given a chance, many industry employees agree that they have fallen behind in terms of what is happening with academics, or they have new roles in their own companies for which they are not actually adequately suited, and they could be certified, they could be trained by the academic institute. So that's where the collaboration can be very strong, especially where it is cross-industry, multidisciplinary kind of roles. It becomes very important. And then also the industry can take in more faculty to bring them up to date with the industry developments. And not only that, when those faculty spend time in the industry and come back, their teaching is that much more relevant. Having seen an organization, having seen problems, they can also appreciate what they teach, and I'm sure they become better teachers because of that exposure. I think today that is one thing that is majorly lacking in our country. At level 5, of course, you have become a kind of a trusted advisor. The institute has become a very trusted advisor to the industry, and the industry is also is almost there on the campus, so to say, and have access to complementary capabilities between each other, and together adopting small and medium industries for using developed competencies, solving the industry problems. And most importantly, if you look at the fourth bullet, that collaboration should be considered as strategic to the company's success in the marketplace. If a industry reaches that level where it says that my collaboration with this institute is strategic for my success in the marketplace, then we can safely say that they have reached a level 5 of collaboration. Okay, and taking the institute and representing it on the company board, company people coming on the institute's board, and so on. So I hope you get the idea of this, what these different levels mean, and how the whole model, how the collaboration, how the relationship matures over a period of time. So the thing, of course, is that both and the industry, they need to understand that if collaboration is to work, the engagement needs to be structured and driven in a certain way. There needs to be governed in a certain way. If you try doing scholarships on the one hand, and then say next quarter I will do something at level 4, normally it doesn't work. It may work for some people, but in majority of the cases, unless they go through a structured process, it is very unlikely to work. Okay, so the model provides a framework for this collaboration and defines these levels of maturity. So what this paper still does not have, and more work is possible, is around one, conducting a survey across the industry and the institutes, trying to validate to what extent this model is correct. If it's not, you know, how do we refine this model? What other activities should be included? Should we, you know, move around the activities, and how do we extend this whole model? And how do you even measure? If you say that an institute is at level 5, how do we say that it's an institute or an industry is at level 3 or level 4 in their collaboration? So how do we actually evaluate and measure? So that is something that one can work at in terms of the coming up with the collaboration index. And it will also help you, help the institutes especially, and the industries of course, to set goals for themselves, saying that today I'm at level 1 by looking at this model. How do I move to level 3? In the next 3 years, can my institute move to level 3 by doing these activities with these industries? Okay, so it helps you that way to set goals for the collaboration itself. Okay, so this is basically a maturity model that I have come up with. There are lots of papers available on the internet about collaboration. If you look at this model as well as some of those papers, I'm sure the whole thing could be useful. At least that's my sincere hope. So this concludes the presentation, and if there are questions, I can take the questions, please.
Thank you, sir. One question is, how can institutes leverage folks from or associated with industry willing to volunteer and help the academia? Are there any ongoing options to use such volunteers?
Okay. From the academia, from the institute's viewpoint, today our own experience is that we have involved people from the industry on our board of studies, as well as to do two kinds of interactions. One, we get them to we have half a day every week dedicated for the industry people to come and talk to our talk to our students, and this can be any set of students. It is not that somebody comes and teaches or talks to engineering, computer science fourth semester. No, it is across the institute. So it is not at a department level, it's at the institute level. The second thing that we have tried to do is give industry related institute level, what we call seminar courses. So it's a 2-credit course, where the student gets 2 credits, somebody from the industry comes and actually teaches its 2-credit course. And we are flexible enough to say that this need not be a regular kind of course where you conduct tests, where you conduct internals, and then you have to correct the papers and all that. The industry people don't want to do that. So we give them enough independence to say, you come, you be part of our board of studies, you tell what should be taught, and if you want to volunteer to teach it in the way you want it, we will give you that flexibility. This has been one of the great things about some of the private universities, and I'm sure a lot more flexibility to the institutes will be given with some of the new rules being framed by the AICT and some of those entities. So that is one way. That is the most successful way, I would say. But the thing is, looking at it from an industry point of view, when that person goes to the institute and spends time with the institute, giving all that knowledge about the industry, what does he get in the industry? Does he lose out on a project? Right? So even the industry has to make sure that, you know, today most of the industries are giving some points for their employees for CSR kind of activity, for example. It's part of their objectives, it's part of their goals. Similarly, the industries which are serious about institute collaboration should put these goals, the collaboration with the institute, as one of the goals for their employees, okay, and that has to be achieved. That goes as part of their appraisal, then it will work. Because unless, you know, it goes as part of his appraisals or there's, you know, money invested in it, nobody takes this thing seriously.
Maturity models have an assessment dimension. Are you planning one? And if so,
yeah,
who would be best suited to do so?
I think the, you know, yes, there is certainly an assessment is absolutely a must, provided, of course, that the self is itself matures in the sense it should be published. Both the industry, first the industry and the institutes have to accept it, which means some of the highest industry bodies like, you know, a CII plus, you know, AICTE or somebody, you know, or a UGC, they have to sit together and make sure that this is more widely publicized, you know, and evangelized, so to say, and come up with, you know, the assessment model also. There are enough people who are interested in doing this, you know, assessment and certification. And but whatever it is, the stakeholders, the main stakeholders, the main industry bodies, as well as the academic bodies, have to come together and do this. Or even something like ISTE. You know, they have to come together and do the assessment. Only then it will have the credibility that it deserves. That's my view.
Level two, you mentioned, is trust-based, which is generally one-to-one personal. How can this be raised to organization-based rather than being restricted to be on a personal-based?
Let me just go back to that slide. Yeah, could you repeat the question?
Level two, you mentioned, is trust-based, which is generally one-to-one personal. How can this be raised to organization-based rather than being restricted to one, only on personal-based?
Okay. Yeah. See, my own experience is that a lot of these things start as, you know, an individual to individual. In fact, if you see the greatest labs in the world or in any institute, whether you go to Trinity or Cambridge or Stanford or anywhere, most of these labs are actually built around a person, around an individual, and that's how it starts, right? And then goes on, because of the senior management involvement as well as the governance that happens at the levels and the visibility that it gets at the highest levels, it then becomes organizational level, okay? And it is going to be no different even in this collaboration. Okay, it has to happen, the trust has to first come at the working level and then move up. Usually when we try to, you know, build the trust at the institute level and then push it down, I find that it normally doesn't work. So it takes people from the industry who have come to academics to go back to the industry, talk to them, start engaging them, and as more and more of these things happen, between the institute and the industry, between different professors, different labs, different faculty and all that, then then the institute management and the industry management start seeing a lot of value in it. That is when you take it to the higher level and create a governance model which makes sure that the governance model should make sure that it then becomes independent of, I wouldn't say independent of individuals, but the dependency on individuals should reduce at that point. But it has to always start at the individual level and then go up rather than the other way down.
Thank you very much, sir. Those were all the questions.
Okay. Thank you very much. And my email ID is there on the front slide, or you can even contact Sridhar. So if there are any more, or if anybody wants to do more work on this along with me, I'd be very happy to collaborate. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and have a great day.
You too, sir.